Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Nibble Urban Survivor. Happy New Year! Did anybody do that dumb joke? They always do. I do that dumb joke all the time where I'm like, hey, guys, I'll see you next year. I used to do that joke all the time, and I'm not going to lie. It's the dad in me who still gets a really huge laugh out of it. But hey, Happy New Year. It's 2021. Sounds like such a futuristic date. We're just like 100 years off from, like, I guess Star Trek becoming a reality. That's kind of cool. And today's date is January 2nd, and we're 2 days into the new year, and that seems like things are going okay. You know, nothing's really bad has happened in the last 48 hours, so fingers crossed we can make it to 3 days, maybe even make it to a whole 4.5 days. I don't know. But I got pretty high hopes for 2021. You know, we got the vaccine and, you know, we'll have a shift in political power. I don't really know if that's going to help at all. But hey, vaccine. So hopefully by Valentine's Day, February 14th, there'll be a romantic opening of all of the restaurants and we'll see a big boom and, you know, all the small businesses will be saved because a lot of businesses are really hurting out there. A lot of small businesses, a lot of restaurants, shops, everything. They're getting destroyed. I don't know what it's like where you live, but I can tell you in California, it's getting really bad because, you know, we've been on lockdown for so long. And just a new restaurant, I feel like, goes out of business every day. And that kind of brings me to today's topic because I got a submission from someone and they said, Nick, I own a, you know, restaurant and I love it. And yes, I know COVID is affecting it, but the one thing I hate is Yelp. I hate Yelp reviews. What can I do to survive Yelp reviews? And that's kind of a good topic for today's episode. If you listen to our episode before this one, I talked with the very hilarious, really, really awesome dude, Matt Fry. And we just talked about the restaurant industry as working as a waiter and dealing with like mean, arrogant customers. Because for some reason, when you give someone like a slight power over somebody else, you know, like an airline attendant, or a poor waiter or waitress, people just become dicks. It's like a cocaine. It's like an addiction. And I don't know why. But the problem is now there's Yelp. So now they can be extra dicks. You know, so like if they, you know, made a scene at your restaurant and they were a jerk to the waiter, the waitress, or the manager, and then they go home and they get on Yelp and they give you like a 1-star review and can totally hurt your business. And that's terrible because it is like that. Like you'll be on Yelp and you know, you might get like 500 4-5-star reviews, but it only takes like 1 or 2 1-star reviews to really hurt you. And it's interesting because, you know, there's Yelp, there's Google, you can do reviews on Facebook. You can do reviews for businesses all over the place. Okay. And I mean, I get it. Like if you really did get scarred by the business or they screwed you over or something, you can give them a bad review and that makes sense and let the whole universe see it, you know? So I get the pros and cons because, you know, back in the day, only a select, you know, few people could be a reviewer. Like we paid people to do like Zagat's and all that kind of stuff. But now, you know, you have the invention of Yelp and the internet and everyone has become like a professional reviewer. And I'm not going to lie, like I use my Yelp reviews all the time to figure out like where to go and where not to go. But nowadays, I don't even know how truthful Yelp is because, you know, you can post on Craigslist and hire people and give each person like $1 to $5 just to give you a 5-star review. And I don't know if that's considered fraudulent. I don't think there's a crime against it. But, you know, it's kind of like how you see like social media influencers and they have like 1 million followers. But out of that 1 million followers, you know, 900,000 of them might just be like, you know, bots or, you know, you can buy users now. So it's really even hard to determine which reviews are right and which reviews are wrong, but still people will base it off of what they see. And it was interesting because at first, you know, when Yelp and all that came out, you were like, oh, this is great. I'm getting real reviews from people that are just like me. You know, they got 2 hands and 2 legs and a mouth. So, you know, it's not like these fancy reviewer people because, you know, I think the thing was is people thought that these fancy reviewers didn't have the same tastes as us commoners. Like, you know, I like Big Macs. Fancy reviewers might like prime rib. We have a little bit of a different palate. Mine is obviously better. So then Yelp came along and was like, well, let's give the power of the reviews to the people because that's going to be a more honest review. And it kind of was for a little bit. Like, you could open up a restaurant, you could find like a couple of hundred reviews, and they were pretty honest because you were getting them from real people. So it seemed like there was a golden age of Yelp reviews, and it was working, and we were all living in harmony and like dancing around trees, and it was like, it's so beautiful, it's so beautiful with the Yelp reviews. But then something happened, and then Yelp reviews just became a thing where people got really hateful. Because there's people on Yelp now who you can just tell, like, if you look at all, like, they've never given anything more than like a 2-star review. And there's just a lot of people out there who I think you just can't satisfy them. And I think at the same time, I don't think they want to be satisfied. I think they just want to complain. And I think my analogy for that would be like an old man sitting on a stoop who just harasses everybody that goes by. And it's like, get off my stoop there, kitty. Oh, these kids today and their wild haircuts and their two-legged legs and they got the shoes with the big red laces. Ooh, you know, and I feel like that's how some people are on Yelp. And I feel like Yelp has a lot of those people now. And that's not good because you shouldn't just make it your life's mission when giving reviews to destroy places, right? So that's the problem now, is that all these restaurants are kind of at the mercy of these weird, crazy Yelp reviewers who will just give you a bad Yelp review. Like, you could break down the door, they could be choking, you could save them from choking, they could be like, oh my God, I think I have a tumor in my brain, and you could be like, you know what, we have a device in the kitchen that could cure that, and you could do that and save these people's lives, but they're still going to go on Yelp that night and give you a bad review because there was too much ice in the ice water. So there's just people that you can't make happy. But it's sad because there are some really, really good businesses out there. There are some really good restaurants out there. But you'll just have people that will give them shitty reviews because you just can't make them happy. Or you'll have people that will give those businesses and restaurants bad reviews because they just don't like them. You know, and it's kind of a weird passive-aggressive way of being, I guess, you know, it's like someone who doesn't like an Italian restaurant because they believe that, you know, an Irish bar should be there, and so they give it a bad review. Shit like that, I've been told, happens on Yelp all the time. So Yelp has mutated into this weird passive-aggressive, this is how I get to review restaurants all from the comfort of my own home because I think I'm a tough guy on the keyboard, but in reality outside, I'm just a big baby. So how do we survive Yelp reviews? And this isn't going to just, you know, be focused, you know, merely on Yelp because Google does reviews, Facebook does reviews, there's review websites. They're all over the place. But I think the two biggest ones are Yelp and Google. Those are the two I think people use the most, Yelp being number one. So how do you survive as a small business Yelp reviews? Because I think the goal of a small business should be not to get Yelp reviews, right? Because a lot of people are like obsessed with getting Yelp reviews. They're like, yeah, give us a 5-star review and we'll give you a free nacho. Or they have like the check-ins. You can do like, hey, check in here and we'll give you a 10% off your bill, which is great. And there are some people that like that will come in, they will use that, and they'll give you probably a good review. But at the end of the day, you've opened up the floodgates for bad reviews. So the only way not to get bad reviews is to have no reviews at all, right? Because here's the thing I've found about people when it comes to shops and restaurants is, yes, they will look you up. Because that's the first thing I do on my phone is I'll just tinker away, look you up, and see what's going on. But I'm not going to lie. If people can't find anything about your store or your restaurant and there's no reviews and there's a like little bit of mystery there, you know, maybe a touch of, they're going to want to see it even more. So the goal of a small business, you know, or a restaurant is to not have reviews because it makes you seem more exclusive. So that's step one. Don't sign up for Yelp. Don't get acknowledged on Google. You almost want to think of yourself as like an underground speakeasy that nobody knows about. And you only have like a select clientele, membership ownership. Those are the key words. It's kind of like those hipster grocery stores. What are those called? Co-ops? You know where everybody like kind of owns the store? Like you'll have like Nick's Grocery Outlet, but then, you know, all the people that work there and shop there are like part owners, and they all have to like contribute and actually like run the register and set up the produce. Actually, if you don't know what I'm talking about, there's a really great King of the Hill episode where Hank Hill joins a co-op so he can get good steaks and produce. If you check out that episode, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. But you should do that with your restaurant or store. Let's turn it into a co-op and make it that the people who want to shop there have to become members and also have to work there. Now, you see what I mean? Because if you do that, they're not going to give you a bad review. Also, you don't let insiders in, because I don't think co-ops let outsiders shop at their store. You have to become a member who also, you know, shops and works there. I believe that's how co-ops work. I'm not sure what the scientific chemistry, you know, is of it. I could always send an email or do Ask Jeeves. Is Ask Jeeves, is that still a thing? I don't know if that's still a thing. So that's what you have to do. Because if you have a co-op, people aren't going to give you a review. Now, if you have a membership, because I know what you're thinking, you're like, well, Nick, what if I just got rid of the whole membership thing and I, you know, co-op thing, and I just did a membership like Costco? See, that's the thing, is like you could still do a membership thing, but people are still going to give you bad reviews, and then they might drop their membership and, you know, go to like Sam's Club or whatever, or Walmart, which actually owns Sam's Club. But if you do a co-op where people have to become members and work there, then your customers who also work at the same place, they're not going to give that place a bad review, because then they're giving themselves a bad review. See what I did there? Yeah, that's right. You see that? I just like blew your mind. I'm just like, I'm killing it today, guys. Blowing minds today. So that's kind of the paradox, which is a scientific French word I just made up. The paradox of how not to get reviews is you have to make your store or restaurant or whatever a co-op, because then the people that shop there are also the employees, and they're not going to give it a bad review, because that would make no sense, because they shop and work there. And guess what? You've built out like a big, you know, I guess samurai wall, because you can't let anybody else in there to shop unless they become a member too. I mean, that's, you know, that's genius, okay? Now, I think that, in reality, is the easiest solution right there, is to go the co-op route, you know? I believe so. I know some people might be like, ugh, Nick, that's a lot of work, because I got to, like, make membership cards and laminate them, and then, you know, my staff isn't really trained. They're just customers that are kind of, like, semi-trained, and, you know, I run a very legitimate high-end business. I get that, okay? So maybe the co-op route isn't for you, but for many of you might be something to consider. But if you're not going to consider it, then I think you need to think of the terms. This isn't step two. This is like option two. We're doing options today, people. So option one is do a co-op. It's great. Option two is you got to think of like a prohibition underground speakeasy. You know, that's what you got to do. Yeah. You got to be completely off the grid. You can't be on the internet. You can't let people know about you, and you always have to be moving locations. You almost have to be like one part speakeasy meets one part pop-up store. Actually, I really appreciate and respect pop-up stores, because by the time you give them shitty reviews, they're gone, and they've moved on to the next town. And then you leave yourself thinking like, oh my God, it's like a Twilight Zone episode. Was that store, was that pop-up Fuko Pop monkey store, was that really there? I don't know. I'm freaking out. Okay, well, don't freak out, because they probably just moved to another kiosk at the mall they could get for like half price. A lot of those pop-ups are like usually Halloween stores. But you got to think of yourself as like one part speakeasy, one part pop-up, and always be on the move. Because then nobody can give you a review if they can't catch you. Right? Kind of like a cat burglar. So again, I guess I'm wrong. It's like one part cat burglar, one part speakeasy, two parts, you know, pop-up store that's always on the move. right? Nobody can give you a review, because that's the one thing about Yelp, right? Is that they do it based on like locations and things like that. But if you're moving around, then it's hard for anybody to really lock down your location and give you a bad review. So it's got to be kind of like on the move. It's kind of like the circus, you know, like the traveling circus. They're here one day, they leave the next day, and then everybody forgets that they were even there. Same idea. So I guess you would say you're kind of like one part, you know, traveling circus, one part cat burglar, one part speakeasy, and then one part pop-up store. So it's those four things, and you combine them into one thing, and that's how you avoid getting bad reviews, because, you know, nobody can, like, lock you down. Also, people don't know that you're the same store. That's the other thing, too, in this option, is constantly be changing your name. You know, so, like, if I was using my name for a pop-up restaurant, I'd be like Nick's Grilled Cheese. And then my next one, I'd be like Nick's Famous Grilled Cheese. And then we move to another location, and then it'd be like Nick's Really Awesome Famous Grilled Cheese. And then we move to, like, a different location, and it's Nick's Ultra Super Famous Grilled Cheese. You see what I'm doing? You got to always constantly, I don't want to say reinvent yourself, because you can still serve the grilled cheese. You just got to change your name, okay? Now, here's the thing. With that, you should be prepared to travel all over the country, because you can only do it, like, I'm in LA right now, so we could do it, like, a couple places in LA until, you know, everybody kind of catches on to what we're doing. And then you got to travel, like, the next town, and then the next town, and then the next town, okay? And the way you want to kind of map out which towns you're going to want to, you know, go to is start with, like, high-tech towns, you know, towns that really use, like, social media and the internet and things like that. And then at the very end of your list, you want to go to towns that, you know, don't even use electricity. So your last pop-up locations will probably be around, like, Amish country or one of those, you know, islands in Hawaii where the people have completely shut themselves off from society and it seems to work for them. I'm not going to lie, they're probably a lot happier than I am. So that's what you want to do when you're traveling. That's option two, which is also a pretty good option. So, you know, option one, do the co-op route. Option two, be like the traveling circus, camp burglar, pop-up, speakeasy route. You know, now option three, because there are some people out there who are like, well, Nick, I can't really move around a lot because I'm old, or, you know, I don't, you know, I have a bad back, which I could totally get that. Or maybe they're like, I signed a lease for like 50 years at this location. Or it's like my mom and pop's like original restaurant and we've had it in the family for 75 years and we can't change anything about it. Now that I get, okay. But how do you avoid getting bad reviews at those places? And this is option three, not the most favorite option, but people will give you 5 stars every time, because I have designed what I think is a loophole on how to get 5 stars all the time. And I'll give you an example of a place that I think knows what they're doing, and that is the Wiener Circle in Chicago. And if you've ever been to the Wiener Circle in Chicago, people love it. And it's just a little hot dog stand. And people love it because they're allowed to yell and curse and throw things at the staff. And people love that. They love a restaurant where they're like, not only do I get to eat a shitty hot dog at 3 a.m, but I get to throw stuff and shout curses at the poor guy making it. And the best is the staff fights back, and it's amazing. So if you can, go on Google, look up the Wiener Circle in Chicago, and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Now, if you look it up on Yelp, I do think it does actually have some bad reviews. But here's the thing, is nobody gives a shit about the bad reviews because they love that you get to go there and just treat the staff like shit. And for some reason, people are addicted to that. If you let people treat your employees like shit, if you let the customers just kick down the door and curse and complain and be mean and get all that like venom out of their body, they will love you for it. And they will come back because it's almost like cheap therapy. Right. So instead of like sitting down and talking to a psychiatrist about your problems or, you know, whatever, your mommy didn't love you. Now you get to go to a restaurant and shout curses at the waiter who's also yelling at you back. And you get to, you know, I guess live out telling your mom everything she did wrong raising you. And on top of that, you get a free meal, you know, because I guess are you paying for the fighting and the food's included? Or maybe you're paying for the food and the free fighting's included. I don't know. Figure it out. But that's how you get a really famous good restaurant, is you let the customers just do whatever the fuck they want. when it comes to yelling at the staff, whistling at them, ringing a bell, throwing stuff at them to get to come to the table, but have the staff give it back to them too. And you just create this huge argument, negative energy cloud where people are just getting it out of their systems. But for some reason, people love that. Because you got to remember, a lot of people today are treated like shit in the office place, or their bosses treat them like shit, and everybody's conniving and lying and, you know, backstabbing each other. So they need a place where they can go and yell at a person and feel like that they're in charge, right? And they've tried to do that with, like, you know, hypnotherapy and actors. And I think they also have what they call those, like, break rooms where you can, like, go in and take a baseball bat and, like, break plates and stuff. See, I don't think that really helps, you know, just taking a baseball bat and violently breaking up an old TV. No, I think people more want to get into it with someone and they just argue about it and they just get it all out there and they just get it out of their systems. It's kind of like, you know, whenever you just like you feel really, really sad and you just have a really, really good cry and you just get all of those like negative, sad emotions out of your body via water out of your eye ducts. It's the same way. So that's how maybe you want to treat your restaurant, and that's option three, is go the Chicago Wiener Circle route. Because that by that time, if anybody even gives you a shitty review, the majority of the people aren't going to care because they're like, well, I get to go to a place where I get to treat the staff like utter shit and get away with it. And the best part about that is you could serve them just like buckets of lard and dirt, and they would probably still eat it because you're allowing them to yell and spit and be mean to the staff, you know? So I think that's, because then, you know, if people even see a bad Yelp review, they're like, well, fuck that guy. He didn't get it. This place is awesome, you know? So I think that's option three, is you need to think about your store as allowing the customers to just come in and just berate you verbally. Now, I don't mean they can do it physically. Obviously, if they touch the staff or if they break something or anything like that, you should have them arrested ASAP. But if they want to complain about their meal and yell at the waiter for 20 minutes and start screaming and make a huge scene, I think that's perfectly normal. And to be honest, I think people are going to really appreciate it. And I think you just have to tell your staff at the end of the day, it's like a lot of people have a lot of psychological baggage that they just want to get out. And sadly, you were the target. But the good thing is you're getting paid to, you know, just stand there and get berated. And I would assume people who do that, they probably are big tippers, too. You know, I would say on that, you know, typically in a restaurant, you tip like 15-20%. I feel like if you're allowed to treat the staff, you know, horribly, you should be tipping at least 50-75%. So you might see an increase, you know, in tips. And obviously, it might not be a bad idea to have a few restaurants or businesses like that right now where people can just kind of come in and, you know, get a lot of that negative venom steam out, because they're going to feel a lot better. You know, because I know a lot of people are always like, oh, yeah, well, you should go to the gym or go for a jog or, you know, get that stress out, take a hot shower. No, I think at the end of the day, I think people just need someone to yell at and to get into an argument with and to win. You know, that could be like a new type of therapy that's created off of my option three restaurant idea, is that you're just a doctor and you just let your clients come in and then just start yelling at you and arguing with you and let them win and get it out. It's kind of a psychotherapy, but I think it's just like, you know, they have it all built up inside. Let them just ejaculate all of that negativity out onto you, and they're going to feel a hell of a lot better. Because sometimes when you just sit down and talk about your problems, they're still building up inside of you. You know, it's kind of like, think of it like this. Like if you have a soda and you shake it up and, you know, you prick a small hole in the bottle cap, right? And just a little bit of the carbon comes out, dioxide or the fizz or whatever the fuck is in it, kind of just leaks out, right? But there's still buildup in there, okay? So really, in reality, even if you poke a hole, which in this analogy is like sitting down and politely talking to a doctor, that's not going to help. That might help over time. That might be decades, right? But you are going to want a psychotherapy where, in this analogy, you can just pop off that bottle cap in one stroke. All that shit comes flying out. It'll take like 5 seconds, like a couple on prom night in high school, best, you know, 10 seconds of their lives. And then they're going to feel a whole lot better, you know? And I think that would be a really cool therapy thing That's not really part of option three, but in reality, what a genius idea, though, if you really think about it. So if anybody ever starts like a psychotherapy place like that, where they just allow people to come in and start screaming at you and yelling at you, could be a big, I mean, that's a trillion-dollar idea right there. Also, you could play the character. Like, if someone wants to come in and yell at their husband, I would be glad if you wanted to hire me and I would just sit on the couch and you could just tell me how much of a loser I am and pay me for that. I would gladly do that. That could be a thing. So if you're an actor who's out of work right now, that might be something you really look into, is asking people like, hey, man, do you want to like yell at your neighbor, or do you want to yell at your boss and tell him what a loser he is? I will gladly dress up like one of those characters. I will sit down, obviously stripper rules, no touching, and you can just berate me for as long as you want. I do charge by the minute. Okay, don't charge by the hour, because some people might prematurely exhaust themselves. Or, you know, some people might actually give themselves like a heart attack. So I would probably sign a waiver in case they like get themselves so enraged yelling at you that they drop dead right in front of you. You know, obviously you don't want to be considered like a Dr. Kevorkian or anything like that. But I'm just saying, from this psychotherapy, this could be something very important and a big moneymaker. So again, if you're, you know, an actor, or if you're a doctor looking to kind of spice up your medical life, this could be the psychotherapy treatment for you, is just letting people yell at you. And again, that also goes back to option three, is create a restaurant where people can also do that, because then at that point, the reviews won't matter. No one's going to care. Nobody will care, and it'll be great. So I think that's really about it. I mean, we came up with three options just to review. Topic of today's show, how to survive, you know, bad Yelp reviews. Number one, do the co-op. Force your customers to be employees. So in reality, they'd have to give themselves bad reviews. Number two, be the speakeasy combined with all those other things I said, the cat burger circus thing. And then number three, the psychotherapy. Let your customers just berate people who work for you. You know, let them yell at the waiter, complain at the retail girl that the shirt was completely out of style, and scream and get all that venom out. Because if we don't, and if we allow these people to keep giving us bad one-star Yelp reviews, then, I mean, psychologically, the economy is going to tank. All these businesses are going to go out of business. And then people are just going to be, like, scared to death to create a new independent or small business, because the reviewers are just going to be chomping at the teeth to destroy it. So here's my final thought of this episode, is think of it like this. When you give a store like that, or a restaurant, independently owned, small business, a bad review, did they really deserve it? Or are you just in the heat of the moment? I think before you give a bad review, I think you should wait a couple of days. Let the venom and the fire die down. And I'll give you an example. I'll end this on a story. I was on Etsy, because I shop on Etsy. I love Etsy. And I bought this bracelet, and it was an Italian horn bracelet. An Italian horn that, like, wards off of evil, right? And the marbles that it made, you know, it was from Italy. And the lady is like, these are from Italy. You know, they're handcrafted. And I remember I asked her before I bought it, I said, well, would it fit a man's wrist? And she said yes, because it had like some elastic material in it, so it could wrap around any wrist. So I said okay, and I paid about $43 for this bracelet. Now, number one, the shipping was almost a week late, so I wasn't happy about that, right? You know, because I feel like she had lied to me, and I was like, oh well, the shipping was late. And then I get the bracelet, it doesn't fit. I mean, it fits on my wrist, but obviously, you know, I felt like she had lied to me, because I asked her if it felt, you know, wrapped around a man's wrist, and obviously it kind of does, but it was like super tight, and if I would have worn it, my hand probably would have fallen off from like poor blood circulation. So I was really pissed off, because I just spent $40 on a bracelet that doesn't even fit me, and now I can't really return it, I can't really ship it back. What am I going to do with it? So I got on Etsy. And I did. I gave it a 2-star review, and I was like, "It's beautiful." I said, "But it don't fit." I was told it was going to fit. The shipping was late. You know, if I'm going to pay this much for a handcrafted bracelet, it best fit. You know, so I was technically, I believe I was right. I was right in giving that review, and then she responded, and she offered to, like, take it back and all this stuff, I think. Or no. Actually, no. If I remember right, she had told me that she's like, well, I told you the shipping was going to be late, and, you know, it's universal one-size-fits-all wrist, which is complete bullshit. It wasn't designed for men. So in reality, I guess I was ordering women's jewelry, and I didn't really, you know, see that. But then I thought to myself, after I gave the review, I was like, you know what? I was like, who gives a flying fuck, right? Because at the end of the day, this lady who's selling these bracelets, you know, one bracelet might equal a meal for her family. You know, one bracelet might keep the gas on, keep the heat going. One bracelet might equal a tank of gas to get her family to the store, get her kids to school. One bracelet might be a new pair of shoes for her son, because he hasn't gotten a pair in a couple of years. And I think that's the thing we forget with small businesses, is that they're not a corporation. You know, they're not backed by millions and billions of dollars. The money they make goes right back into their business and goes right into supporting themselves and their family. There's no board of directors. There's no fancy bullshit. So I want you to think about that when you're giving a bad review. And I think the best thing to do, you know, and my dad would tell me this all the time, and he still tells me this to this day, because I can be a very vengeful Italian, is just walk away. And that's what I did. You know, I put the review up there, and then I immediately regretted it because I feel like a big asshole, and I contacted Etsy, and I was like, take this fucking review down, because I don't want to be, you know, what I would describe as like a douchebag. And that's the thing, people. Don't be a douchebag. If you had a bad experience at a mom and pop, or you just didn't like a store because the t-shirt you bought didn't fit or whatever, just walk away. Who gives a shit? Right? You know, think of it like this. Like, your bad review, it isn't going to hurt them. It isn't going to help them. Who cares? You learned your lesson. You knew never to go there again. Right? So, at the end of the day, with the small businesses and the mom and pops, if you had a bad experience, who gives a shit? Life goes on. You still get to go, you know, you still get to wake up tomorrow morning and get your little mocha frappuccino Starbucks drink, right? Life isn't that bad for you, okay? I don't know if you know what it's like in other countries right now, where some people are just, you know, more concerned if they're going to actually get to eat that week or get clean water. But I want you to think about that. Because at the end of the day, we got to help each other. The small businesses right now, they're teetering because of COVID. And doing a stupid review online can be the teeter that knocks it right off the cliff and destroys it. Personally, I think reviews are fucking stupid, if you ask me. You know, like, I know podcasts get reviews. We get reviews for this show. We've gotten, I think, 22 of them. I think we have a really, really good show. But you got to remember, like, you know, reviews deter people. If you see a restaurant and they get bad reviews, you're probably not going to go there. And they could have amazing food. You could be actually missing out. You know, and then there's restaurants or podcasts that have great millions and millions and millions of reviews. But that doesn't mean they're any good. It's kind of like that old saying is, just because he has a degree from Harvard doesn't mean he's smart. And that's the thing with reviews, is sometimes I think we get blinded by them. So don't get blinded. Just try it out for yourself. And if you don't like it, don't go back to it. You know, if you don't like our show, just don't listen to it again. Bada boom, bada bing. It's that simple. And with that, that is our time. Again, guys, thank you so much for listening to the Nimble Urban Survivor. Remember, if you ever want to be a guest on the show, or if you ever want to talk about anything, you can reach out to me via my website at www.catellicomedy.com. Guys, it's 2021. There is a vaccine. Things are going to get better. And I'm not going to lie, by Valentine's Day, you might be having it in a restaurant. I know I won't. I'll probably just order a pizza for me and my wife. So, guys, with that, have a great week, and I will talk to you guys later. Also, feel free to give us a review if you want. You don't have to, but, you know, I know the whole episode was like, don't give us a review, but, you know, we might,
you know, appreciate the review.